If you do this over and over, you will become an expert quitter.
If you had seen my graph at Garden City back in the early 90s, there would have been this.
So Lee, when I was writing Elements of Poker, I had all these topics that I wanted to share, and I had to decide which one to start with.
Right.
And I decided to start with the topic that was the most valuable to my clients, the one that made them the most money.
Which was?
Quitting.
There you go.
That's basically how I opened the book with how to quit.
So we've waited 20 some episodes to get to this one, but it's important. Take notes.
It's such a big problem for so many people.
Yes.
And especially for people that already have a good game. It's like they play well, and the big hurdle is playing consistently well. And it's at the end of the sessions is when we tend to erode. And a lot of people tend to play worse when they're stuck.
Oh, no. For me, it's not the end of the session. It's the last 4 hours of the session that should have never been.
Yeah, exactly. Right. I mean, have you ever like thought of, if you could like rate your results or even get the data on your results, hour one of every session, hour two of every session.
No, I have an app that you can do that. You just put in your stack size at every time you want to, and it shows you a graph. So and if you'd seen my graph at Garden City back in the early 90s, there would have been this.
If we could just chop off the end of our sessions when we are playing bad, that would be enormous. One of my early clients, one of my very first guys, he said, I'm ahead every night at midnight, and I'm broke every night at 3 a.m.
Right.
And I said, well, you just have Cinderella Syndrome.
Right.
You just need to get out of town by midnight.
It's midnight.
Yes, so it is.
Goodbye.
But that really would be the solution for a lot of us.
For sure.
Is to just quit before we hit Disasterville.
You know, I have a bluegrass picking buddy who says, if you hear the birds chirping as you crawl into your tent, you know you're screwed. The poker equivalent of that is that if you see the exercise videos,
oh yes,
come on the
absolutely
TV in the poker room,
right,
you know you're screwed.
Right.
You shouldn't have been there.
Yeah.
And I can remember seeing the exercise videos, come on. This is not good. And it rarely correlated to me having a giant pile of chips. So Tommy, how do we quit?
How do we get better at quitting?
How do we get better at quitting?
Training.
Okay.
And the best bit of training you can do, I feel, is to take a lot of breaks.
Okay.
And to think of your breaks as quitting practice.
Yes.
Because if you think about it, after we're, 8 or 10 hours, you're stuck there and you're, no thought of quitting, it's like you don't even want to get up and go pee sometimes.
Right.
You just don't even want to break the chain of whatever the hell is going on there mentally.
Yeah.
But if you can train yourself to do nothing more than just get out of the chair. Even online players, just get up, walk around the chair.
Right.
Live players, even when you're winning, when you're losing, when you feel good, feel bad, if you take a lot of breaks, and if you actually think of that as training for getting up when you don't want to.
Right.
This is how, over time, months and years, it is possible to retrain yourself to be a good quitter.
Train yourself to let go.
I think you could also see it as a potential quit. Like, I have a client who, every 2 hours, he goes out to his car, and he sits in his car. And so then he's like, okay, I'm in my car. I can go back in the poker room, or I can go home. Either option is on the table.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. Right?
And you can do that without going to the car. If you take a lot of breaks and you get into the habit of asking yourself, do I want to keep playing? How much longer am I going to keep playing?
Right.
I'm supposed to go to a picnic with my family tomorrow. It's already 2 a.m. You know, you have a chance to think about
this. Let's talk about that picnic with the family, because one way that people can really effectively quit, including me, is make a date.
Yeah.
Have a dinner date. Have, know, a movie that you're going to go see with somebody, whatever it is.
Goodbye.
No, wait.
you say, okay, at 7 p.m., I'm going to meet you at this restaurant for dinner.
Yeah.
And then if you have any kind of self-respect, you're going to be there at 7 o'clock because you've told that person you're going to be there.
Right.
So whatever happens, win, lose, or draw, at 6:30, I have to cash out and head off to my dinner date.
Right. So it's a curfew.
It's a self-imposed curfew that is weighted down by another human being that is expecting your presence.
Let's talk about stop losses as they pertain to quitting.
Okay.
You know, a lot of people will go with, say, three buy-ins in their pocket because they know that if they get stuck three buy-ins and they have two more buy-ins in their pocket, bad things could happen.
We actually have a video.
We
about
do.
About bankrolls.
There's a link right there.
Yeah. And you can go watch that video and find out if maybe that bankroll problem applies to you. But anyway, you're talking about stop losses.
Yeah. Well, stop losses are a good thing when they're needed.
Right.
Ideally, we would be able to have all of our bankroll with us and wouldn't need them.
Right.
But it's part of a planned quitting strategy.
Right.
And and should be part of a plan to get better at quitting.
Yes.
To know how many buy-ins you can lose and still be playing your A game.
Right.
And know what that number is. If you need damage control by limiting the amount of money you have in your pocket, then do that.
And that is a very effective way of quitting. Because if there's no money in your pocket, then you gotta go home.
Right.
And if absolutely necessary, don't take your ATM card. Just say, okay, this is the amount of money, and if I go through that, that's the end of my poker for today, and the world is not gonna end.
One thing I hear all the time that I'd like to debunk is the argument that, oh, the game was so good I had to keep playing.
Right.
This to me is one of the most flawed statements in poker, and all it is for.
And it's not that we don't love David Sklansky. David was the one who first said that in a very clear statement. He said there's no good time to leave a good game.
Yeah. Well, now you got to keep in mind, now there are some conditions under which that does hold true. If you're a high stakes player and the games only run a certain amount of time and there's big whales, this is a whole different, and I've coached guys like this, this is a different situation.
Right.
There are times when their living depends on their ability to go ahead and power through that 15-hour session.
I think I can.
And so when Sklansky was writing that, he's talking about 20-40 and 40-80 limit hold'em games back in Vegas, and sometimes those games really sucked. Sometimes they were really, really good.
Right.
So there were times when it could make sense to keep going.
Right.
But that's not us. That's not who we're talking about now. Mm-hmm. We're talking about wanting to play our A game all the time and lop off our C game by not playing when we're in this terrible mindset or bring ourselves back. Okay.
Right.
So the way I debunk the whole thing about, oh, the game was so good I had to keep playing is, let's say you're a 2-5 player, and let's say your hourly earn in a normal game is 40 an hour.
Okay.
Okay. And now the game is extra good. But you're a tight player, right? You're only still going to play not many hands.
Right.
You know, the game, the difference in your hourly earn from the game being like normal to being like great is like maybe 40 an hour to 60 an hour.
Yeah, really, if it's a really good game.
Yeah. That's it.
Yeah.
Right? So if you're already stuck and steaming and playing bad, you're stuck three buy-ins and you're telling yourself, oh, I have to keep playing because the game is good. The extra value of that game being good is only $20 an hour to you.
Right.
So basically, it's a way of deluding ourselves into keeping playing by coming up with a believable story that legitimizes this self-destructive act of continuing to play when you know you're not playing well. So anytime you hear that little voice telling you, I have to play because the game is good, don't listen to that.
Let's talk about locking up a win.
Okay.
And there's both good and bad aspects to that. If you have the habit of locking up every small win and running out of the casino, but then playing until the exercise videos when you're stuck, it's not going to end well. There's an expression that some of the old-time poker players like to use.
Eats like a bird, shits like an elephant.
Right.
This is about the guy who comes in and plays for half an hour and doubles up and quits. And the same guy, if he loses that first pot, will play 10 hours if he's stuck.
Right. And then lose 8 buy-ins.
Right.
Okay. Don't be that guy. All right.
All righty then.
However, I think there are times when it is absolutely correct to lock up a win. Let's say that you've had three losing sessions, and then you get into a session and you play for 2 hours and you just run like God. Everybody throws their money at you and you win three buy-ins. Mm-hmm. And the game is still good. The whale's still there.
Yeah.
It is 100% fine to say, do you know what? I really feel like locking up this big win. Cash out. Go have lunch to celebrate. I just want to celebrate. Say, another day of living. And it's good for your psyche and it's totally fine.
Yeah, it is. I strongly support that.
Yeah.
There are definitely times where just winning, mm-hmm. just locking up a win is the most important thing to your overall poker health.
Yes.
When you're just beaten down.
I actually have this kind of bizarre loss of focus. Sometimes if I get way ahead in the game, my focus slips. As if my mind goes, we got this. We don't even have to think about it. They're just going to throw chips at us.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
All we have to do is flop sets and take a stack from Ace King.
Yeah.
And when I see myself doing that, it's absolutely crucial that I get out of the chair immediately. Go have a cup of coffee. Go walk down the street. Go do something.
Right.
And then come back and say, okay, brain, are you back?
Yeah.
Are we still in our A game here? And if I have to pick up from the table and go be gone for an hour and come back and maybe I get into not as good a game or whatever, okay.
Yeah.
But the important thing is that I'm not sitting on a three buy-in win and then suddenly just start spewing it off because I'm not paying close attention.
Right. So when you say lose focus, is it that you're overconfident? Or you just see too many hands? No.
It seems to be an overconfidence
thing.
Like, I notice that I'm not paying attention to all the stuff that I know I'm supposed to be paying attention to. Somehow it's like I don't have to do it anymore because I'm God's gift to poker and the chips are just going to come flying in. So, the summary of quitting is...
Cheap weapon is surprise.
The summary of quitting is breaks are a great...
Two weapons are fear and surprise.
The summary of quitting is...
Amongst our weaponry are such diverse elements as fear, surprise, are coming again.
The quitting summary is that breaks are a great way to practice quitting and to actually quit if it's the right time to do so.
Yeah, give yourself a chance to reevaluate.
And that locking up a win can be good or bad, depending on the circumstances under which you're doing it.
Right. And just because the game's good doesn't mean you have to keep playing. So let's give a quick demonstration on how to practice quitting. This is it. This is all you have to do.
Watch carefully, people.
If you do this over and over, you will become an expert quitter.
These guys know what they're talking about. You should subscribe. It is a massive plus EV move. If you don't know what that means, you should definitely subscribe. You might just want to celebrate.